Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Hello, my name is Dr. Himanshu Tyagi and I am teaching this course on heat and mass transfer, and let us go ahead with today's lecture, which will be an extension of the convection fundamentals that we have been studying so far. So, if we look at today's lecture number 17 is titled forced convection, and we will look at one aspect of forced convection, which is for external flows. Before we do that, let us do a recap of what we have done in the last class, which is about the fundamentals of convection. We have looked at flow past a flat plate and how does the momentum and heat transfer parameters vary in that. So, using the Blasius solution, we had looked at things like the overall drag force, overall rate of heat transfer which is taking place from the plate. So, using Blasius solution, we have found out the overall Nusselt number. I will highlight it with red color over here with red border, and the overall convective heat transfer coefficient over here, because these are very important for engineers in order to calculate the overall rate of heat transfer from this flat plate to the fluid surrounding it. So, these are very interesting results that we have obtained. Next, we look at the concept of analogy between momentum, heat and species transfer or mass transfer equations, and we looked at the analogy with the help of non-dimensionalizing the equations. So, if we did that, ultimately what we found is these two equations written on the lower right hand side corner, one is for momentum written as m and one is for heat written as h over here. So, both are actually very similar equations, and this inspires us to look at the modified Reynolds analogy, also known as the Chilton-Colburn analogy, which actually essentially says that if we know the value of CFX, we can calculate NUX, the local Nusselt number from the coefficient of friction local, and vice versa. So, these are very interesting things that we have looked at. Now, we will look at the application of these things in external flows. Before we do that, let us also introduce one concept, which is the slight difference between the characteristics of the laminar and turbulent flow. So, this we will explain with the help of momentum transfer and heat transfer. So, as shown in these lot of pictures on this particular slide, we can see some places the flow is laminar, in some cases flow is turbulent, in some case it starts as laminar and then becomes turbulent over here, and the sketch on the right hand side shows the schematic for each one of them. So, if I ask the question to our students that if I take a velocity measurement probe and we will draw it with the red dot over here, and I put at this point A over here in the laminar case, and then I will compare it with point B over here in the turbulent case. And I can do it for all the pictures over here. I can here say this is point A and this is point B. So, remember what we are trying to do is we are trying to measure velocity in the x component at time A. So, it will be a function of time, and the same thing we are trying to do is the x component velocity at point B as a function of time, just for interest sake. And later on we will do the same thing with other parameters like temperature. So, I want to measure temperature at point A as a function of time, temperature of point B as a function of time, then similarly related to pressure, I can do pressure at point B, pressure at point A, I can also do with densities. And let us see if we make the characteristic plot and I want to compare. So, A and B are different in one sense that A would be always laminar and B is always turbulent. Then let us see if we plot the temperature, the temporal plot, which means as a function of time, how will the plot look like. Let us go ahead and do that. So, I will move on to the next slide. So, I want to make the plot for two cases, laminar case and turbulent case. So, for the laminar case, what happens is the flow, if it is steady, it is not changing with time. So, I will say UAT at any given point. So, the in the steady state condition, this line remains flat, which signifies that the velocity, it is not changing as a function of time. And the same thing if we do for turbulent case, maybe this point for point B, here also the mean velocity may remain constant, so which I am showing with the dotted line. But if you look at the instantaneous velocity, it is actually all over the place. So, it will in turbulent cases, it may go up and down, very fluctuating, may go like this. And why is it so? Because in the case of turbulent flows, there are a lot of eddies which are actually passing around. So, it could be very small size eddies, large size eddies. So, these are kind of fluctuations, whereas in the laminar flow, the temperature, the velocity is very uniform over here. So, as we can see, there is a lot of differences in the velocity profile. The way I have drawn them, both the mean velocities are same. So, for the laminar case as well as for the turbulent case, if I put a number over here, if this is 10 meters per second, here also the mean velocity is same. But in turbulence, in addition to the mean flow, mean bulk flow, there are also fluctuations overriding on top of that. So, which means in case of turbulence, I can write the velocity as a function of time essentially as a mean component u bar, which is having this particular value. So, this is my mean value u bar, plus I can write it as a fluctuating component u prime t. So, I will define it in this way, that this is the overall velocity, which is this is the average or mean velocity, and this is the fluctuating component. And this we have done only for one parameter, which is the velocity in the x direction. And the same thing we can write for velocity in the y direction, which would be v. For temperature also, for pressure and densities and other factors as well, which means very quickly we can write velocity in v direction will also turn out to have a bulk component or the average component, and then a fluctuating component. The temperature also will have the mean temperature plus a fluctuating temperature. Even if I make the pressure term, it will also have a mean pressure plus a fluctuating pressure over here. Which means, if I go ahead and write on top hand side certain parameters for laminar case, which is the shear stress is simply del u by del y. So, this I am writing for this particular case over here. If the flow is laminar, and if it is, if I want to write for the heat transfer rate, it is simply del t by del y. Now, I want to write the same thing for turbulent case. Will the expression remain the same or will it change? That is the question that I want to start today's lecture with, is the question mark over here. So, the answer is, let us try and analyze the answer from our common sense and from our experience in real life. What we have seen is that in terms of mixing, if you want to mix, let us say I have a cup of tea over here and I want to mix certain sugar in it, and I want to keep the flow laminar, which means lower Reynolds number, not lot of fluctuations, then perhaps my experience may suggest that it may take a longer time for that mixing to happen. So, this is the mixing of two species, sugar in water or in tea. The same thing may happen for heat transfer as well. If there are two fluids we are trying to heat a fluid, but that fluid is laminar, there is no fluctuations, there are no perturbations. So, in order to heat it, it may take longer time. But at the other end, if we use some sort of a stirring mechanism, where we keep the bulk velocity same, but we introduce lot of fluctuations inside over there, like we generally do with a cup of, with a spoon inside this particular tea, then perhaps the mixing rate actually increases as well, and the same thing may be observed thermally as well, which means that we may expect that the shear rate as well as the rate of heat transfer may actually increase because of all these perturbations and all these fluctuations which are present in the turbulent case. And this is actually seen to be true, and it is named as the turbulent stress or the Reynolds stress. So, let us go ahead and write those components over here. And we are now, for the laminar case, this is very straightforward and simple, we have already written it, but let us now write for the turbulent case. So, in the turbulent case, the total shear stress will consist actually of two components. So, the first component will be very similar to the one given over here, which means the bulk velocity, the gradient in the bulk velocity also will play a role. So, instead of writing del u by del y, perhaps it will make sense if I use the del u bar over here, because I am looking at the gradient. So, this thing is the gradient of the mean velocity. So, this would be the term which is very similar to the laminar case over here. So, I can highlight this blue circle over here is very similar to this blue circle over here, right? I am just replacing u with u bar. But in addition to that, one more term actually comes over here, which I will write as this. This is minus rho, which is density, u prime v prime, and then I will put a whole bar on top of it. So, let me fix this part. And I am taking a mean of u prime into v prime. And what are u prime and v prime? Are these parameters over here. So, u prime is the fluctuating component of the x direction velocity, and v prime is the fluctuating component of the y direction velocity, right. So, this extra term is known as the Reynolds stress or the turbulent stress. So, maybe I will put a box over here. Let me go ahead and do that. And this component over here is known as the Reynolds stress and also known as the turbulent stress. I hope this part is clear. So, this component, even though it has a negative sign, in reality what it is doing is, it is increasing the effective value of the shear stress. And in other words, what it is actually doing is, it is actually increasing the apparent viscosity of the fluid. Now, very interesting phenomena we are seeing over here. Let me go ahead and first write and then try to explain, which means this equation over here, left hand side remains the same. Right hand side, can I write it in terms of this? So, I am combining these two terms together, the first term and second term, using only the gradient of the first term. And this particular part is known as the turbulent viscosity. What was mu originally? This was the viscosity of the fluid. So, in other words, one way of looking at this particular equation over here in green star is that whether the flow, once it becomes turbulent, its apparent viscosity increases, because now the total viscosity becomes not just mu, but mu plus mu t. And what this equation suggests is, keeping the same bulk flow of 10 meters per second, if I start decreasing the fluctuations, which means if I start making it less and less turbulent, so mu is the property of the fluid, which means if it is the fluid is air, then mu value is different, if it is water, it is different. But mu t we cannot measure for water or for air, it is for that particular fluid having a certain amount of turbulence in it, which means if water is remaining still in some cup over here, there is no motion, there is no fluctuation, then what is the value of mu t for water, turbulent viscosity for water? It is 0 because it is stationary. Okay. So, what I can write it in terms of, maybe I will explain it with some curve over here, that I will draw 3 different type of turbulent flows having the same bulk velocity or the same mean velocity. So, in all these 3 cases, so what I am plotting is u as a function of t, this is also u as a function of t, and this is also u as a function of t. And let me put a mark over here which shows 10 meters per second. So, this thing is 10 meters per second over here, same thing here, same thing here. So, if I put a dotted line and a dotted line and a dotted line. So, in the first case, my turbulence value is very less, so it is low turbulence, so it looks something like this. In the second case, the turbulence is slightly medium over here, medium turbulence. In the third case, the turbulence value is very high. So, over here essentially what we are seeing is, in technical terms, we would define it in terms of the root mean square velocity, RMS is low, maybe I will put value is less than 0.5 meter per second. Over here, root mean square velocity is about 2 meters per second, and over here root mean square velocity is 5 meter per second. So, I am not defining root mean square velocity, these things students can look up themselves, but here I am saying that the turbulence intensity is low, here the turbulence intensity is medium, and here the turbulence intensity is very, very high. And that thing we can see graphically, it is given by the fluctuation amount which is actually taking place over here. And in extreme case, I will also draw the fourth case maybe over here. Here turbulence is 0. So, if turbulence is 0, then you get a straight line with no fluctuations. So, here I can say root mean square velocity is 0 and turbulence is 0. Now, we go back to the previous equation's definition and we are seeing that tau total is being defined as mu plus mu t del u bar by del y. So, over here we can clearly see that mu t in this particular case is almost 0, here mu t value is low, here it is medium, and here mu t is kind of high. Because we are increasing the fluctuations, we are making the flow more turbulent. How do I make the water inside this particular cup turbulent? I start moving it very vigorously with the help of a spoon, that makes it more and more turbulent, which means this, the first mu is a property of the fluid . The second mu t is a property of the flow, and this is very interesting, it happens something like this. So, the thing that students may actually remember from here essentially is that if we are having the turbulent flow, then the amount of mixing, the amount of momentum mixing, mass mixing and heat mixing which actually increase, which means the same type of equation I can write for the heat transfer rate. So, in that particular case, for the laminar case, maybe I will use a new sheet over here. For laminar case, I can simply say q dot is minus k del t by del y. But when it becomes turbulent, then I have to add one more kt over here and make this t as t bar. So, I will put a bar over here. And why am I doing it? Because there is a turbulent thermal conductivity component as well, which comes from here, which is rho Cp V into T. In other words, maybe I will put a prime over here, rho prime V prime into T prime. So, this part is known as the turbulent thermal conductivity, this Kt. Which is a property of the flow, and this small k over here is the simple thermal conductivity that we have been studying so far, of fluid, which is the property of the fluid. So, by making the laminar flow actually turbulent, we can apparently change the properties of that particular fluid. So, always remember the word apparently, because we are not actually changing fluid property, but we are changing apparent fluid property. So, I think this was one thing that we have to study before we enter into the external type of flow. So, now what we are going to look at, because the reason for studying this laminar and turbulent cases is very important, because in real life, although laminar is very easy to solve and we can get mathematical answers, but in real applications, unfortunately, almost all of the things which take place as large scale, large velocity, they actually lie in the turbulent regime. So, we must have correlations even for turbulent regime, even though they are slightly less accurate than laminar, they have not been derived analytically, but rather obtained empirically. So, some examples we will look at from now onwards. Now, what we want to focus on is that forced convection, if it is taking place. So, if you remember, we have told that if some blower, some fan, compressor, pump or some actual active device, maybe it is a lung which is actually throwing away the fluid, if the fluid is actually being moved by some externally driven powering agency, then we are terming it as forced convection. And forced convection can take place at various surfaces. If I have over here, some air is blowing on top of this hot surface, then I would say that because this surface is surrounded by air on all sides, so then it is the type of external convection, because all the things are external, all the air is actually surrounding it. And the reverse can also take place. If I make a pipe and fluid is flowing through the pipe, then actually the fluid is contained inside the pipe. So, there it will be the case of internal forced convection. So, we will look at both of them relationship separately, and we will start with the external forced. So, we are looking at forced convection for the external type of flow, and some examples, let us look at it. So, best example is this flat plate. If it is heated, then some air is going on top of it. Then this air is taking away heat. So, this heat we want to find out how much it is taking. So, this is an example of external force convection. If instead of this, let us take an aerofoil shape over here, this could be a gas turbine blade. Then hot gases are flowing around it, and usually over here the temperature of these gases is very high, that we have to figure out what is the rate at which heat is actually entering this gas turbine blade. Because as collaborators with metallurgical engineers, we have to figure out that temperature does not cross a particular limit. So, this also is an example of external flow in which convective heat transfer is taking place. I can change this aerofoil shape and actually make it spherical or cylindrical also. So, if this is a hot, high temperature cylinder which is surrounded by cold air over here, so, then some sort of a heat transfer will take place here also. So, I want to find out Q dot convection value. So, in all these cases, so this can be a cylinder, I can also make it a sphere. So, in all these cases, one thing is common, that the object is surrounded by flow on all sides. So, let us say on a cold day, if I am standing outside and wind is blowing left to right. So, I can assume myself from the top view to be a cylinder of a particular height. Then in reality that actually takes place. So, this is an example of external convection as well. So, my body is at, let us say I am standing in Kanpur in winter temperature, 10 degree air is blowing, and my skin temperature could be around 32, 35 degree centigrade. So, I am losing lot of heat. So, in winters we will wear lot of sweaters and jackets in order to protect this cylinder, which is actually me, from losing heat to the air. So, this is what I will study it like a external flow. So, forced convection taking place in external flow. So, let us start with that, and even though we are looking only at forced convection, again two parameters we will always look at. One is the value of the coefficient of friction, and the second one is the Nusselt value. So, this one. Before I go into details for all these type of cases and try to explain the value of CFX and NUX, let us look at very quickly one very fundamental difference between a streamlined body and a bluff body. So, this could be a streamlined body over here, and the same thing if I make it vertical, then it can become a bluff body. So, if fluid is flowing over here or compared to the fluid is going over here, so I think this we have seen earlier. So, some sort of a wake or eddy region will be developed over here, and here we will have PA, pressure at point A and pressure at point B. There will be huge difference between these two pressures over here. So, the drag force experienced by this particular body over here will be predominantly due to friction. The drag force experienced by this body over here will be predominantly due to pressure drag. So, in reality, all objects in real life are somewhere in between a streamlined body and a bluff body. So, let us say somebody is driving a car or a scooter. So, that car, that scooter, truck, aeroplane, these things are somewhere a compromise between fully streamlined body and a bluff body. So, this is an example of a bluff body over here. Spheres and cylinders are perfect bluff bodies, they do not have any streamlines around them. But we can create streamlines by, you must have seen very high speed cyclists, they usually they wear some helmet which is these days shaped like this. So, instead of wearing spherical helmets like we all do in big cities like Delhi and Bombay, so their helmet, if this is the top view of the helmet I am drawing, so they are trying to make this red sphere as a streamlined green body over here, so that instead of the flow going like this over here with some recirculation region, so they are avoiding the recirculation, making the flow very smooth over here, very streamlined. So, using some expensive methods and other techniques, we can always convert a bluff body into a streamlined body. In some cases, it is worthwhile to do that, in some cases, it is not worthwhile. So, with that, let us begin our analysis. And the simple case that we will take is that for the case of flow over a flat body. So, we will say a flat plate is there, and we want to figure out what is the overall value of CF for this particular flat body and the overall value of Nusselt number for this particular flat body. So, in order to calculate the overall value of CF, what we are going to do is we are going to take an average by integrating CFX as a function of x from 0 to L. The same thing we will do for Nusselt number, but we do not exactly do it for Nusselt directly, we first do it for H 0 to L HX DX, and based on this H we can convert into Nusselt by just simply writing Nusselt is HL by K. So, in both these cases, what we are doing is we are trying to convert the local values which are given by this subscript x over here or over here with hx. So, we are trying to convert the local value into the overall value, the average value which applies for the whole scale. So, this thing is important because these things we are looking on a macro scale. So, let us look for the result for the flat plate that is usually obtained, and we will have two equations, one for the laminar case and one for the turbulent case. So, let us start for the laminar case. So, for laminar case of a flat plate of length L, so CF value is 1.33 divided by square root of REL, and this I think we all our students remember, this is for Reynolds number less than the critical value, because if it is more than 5 lakh like written over here, the flow will actually turn turbulent. So, for that we have to use a different correlation. So, if the flow is turbulent again of the entire length of the plate is L, so over here we have to use a different correlation, 0.074 divided by Reynolds L, and here the power is not 1/5, but it is actually 1/5. notes over here. These are correlations which are obtained from any standard textbook, and engineers can use them for different type of problem solvings over here. So try and remember that this particular expression, I think students are seeing earlier also in our previous lecture, just before this one, we have actually derived it by taking an average for the whole plate. So we calculated the whole force which is exerted on the plate, divided it by the surface area, we got the shear stress, divided by half rho a square, and we got the skin friction coefficient. So I think these are very interesting things that we have obtained earlier also. The same thing, this is for momentum transfer, so we are talking about drag force related things. The same thing can be obtained for heat transfer. So again we are on the flat plate geometry, so we are talking about flat plate, and here we have two correlations for Nusselt number as well. First is the laminar case, so we are taking flat plate length is L. So Nusselt number in this case, this is something also we have derived earlier. So, I am just rewriting that thing, students can remember we are getting this value Reynolds to the power half, Prandtl to the power 1 by 3. And here we will write two conditions under which it is actually true, that Reynolds number has to be less than the critical Reynolds number, which is 5 lakhs, and Prandtl number has to be greater than 0.6. So, that also correlation is available. And in that case, it is again HL by K and 0.037, Reynolds 0.8, Prandtl 1 by 3. And this correlation, when it is true, so this correlation is true where the Reynolds number is higher than the critical Reynolds number over here, but lower than 10 to the power 7. So then Prandtl number has to be greater than 0.6, but less than 60. So these are some empirical relations which are obtained for turbulent case. Now the interesting thing, I do not think any student has to remember these numbers, but the concept they have to remember, that how are these things changing with x, what power of Prandtl number is it typically dependent on, and if you look at the variation of h with x over here, and it is a very interesting curve, it is same for both, whether it is hx or it is cfx, and when I write the subscript x, it means I am talking about the local value. So this curve will is going to plot local heat transfer coefficient or the local friction coefficient cfx, and both are actually same curve qualitatively speaking. It starts off with very high value over here, then something happens, goes up over here, maybe I will draw it again, maybe something like this, then goes down. So this zone over here, if the students remember, what is this zone over here? So the first part is the laminar part, then the last part is the turbulent part, and in this zone in between we have that transition zone. And remember, this transition zone in reality is very, very small, just for the explanation of concept that we are making it slightly significant, where usually it is very small, few microns probably, and it keeps on fluctuating as well. So sometimes that is what transition means, at that point sometimes the flow is laminar, sometimes it is turbulent. So if you look at that particular part, it becomes laminar, turbulent, it is kind of fluctuating, it is transiting, that is why it is known as the transition zone. It is not a regime on its own, it is that particular small thickness in which either the flow becomes laminar or turbulent, it is kind of moving. If you are below it, then flow is always laminar, if you are after it, flow is always turbulent, there is no transitions here, but in between somewhere over here there is transition. So I think this is a very powerful curve over here, that we can see that both of these, they actually start off with very high values when they start off. Then when I will draw the boundary layer over here, where so this thing corresponds to this particular zone, so the boundary layer goes like this, and this is transition, then it becomes turbulent. So this is the laminar boundary layer, it is turbulent boundary layer. So this is a very good overlap between these two figures over here. So this is the boundary layer. So this makes the picture clear. So I think concept wise make it more clear. Equations you can solve on your own. You can figure out what exact value, whether it is 0.664 or 0.037. So these numbers by themselves are not that important, but if you have understood the concept, then you can always extend it to other things as well. So I think this is a very nice thing we have looked at. So external forced convection we wanted to start. So first part we have done for that. First part was that we will look at the flat plate geometry. Now let us look at another interesting geometry, which is the bluff body. So we will look at two cases, that we will look at spheres and cylinders. And I think we all growing up we have been playing with all type of spheres. The best sphere to play with is balls. You can have cricket ball, football, tatty ball and some other things over here. So what I am going to focus today a little bit is something known as the golf ball. And the golf ball is very unique in such a way that intentionally, I think many students who might have seen it. So if you take a perfect sphere, so our TT ball and other balls are kind of perfect sphere. But in golf ball, what we will do is there are certain dimples which are present. So dimples are some sort of a dents which are present over there. So what could be the reason for that? So today I will try to show with the help of example. So what is the reason for these dimples in a golf ball? And maybe the answer may come from, if you look at this flat plate over here and then air is blowing over it. So in order to actually stop it from moving, I have to apply a certain force. So I can say some drag is being applied over here by air. I will say FD1. In order to counter FD1, I have to put an equal and opposite force FT2 in this direction. So, does this drag force play a role somewhere over on the golf ball? That is what we will try and look at today. So, let us start with some of the images that I have collected and we will look at that image. So, what we want to look at is the flow across cylinders and spheres, and this is a golf ball we have seen photograph over here, and these dimples are very clear. So, you can see these circles I can draw over here. So, these are all example of dimples. So before we answer this question that why are there dimples on the golf ball, let us first look at in general some knowledge about the flow across spheres and cylinders. So the first case I will take is the flow across spheres, and what I am going to do is I am going to go from low Reynolds number to medium to high Reynolds number and try to share with student that what exactly actually happens over here. So we will start at very very low Reynolds number, let us say Reynolds number 20. And we remember Reynolds number was always a ratio of two forces. One is the inertial force to the viscous force. So Reynolds number is very low, which means relatively speaking velocities are very low, inertial force is very low, the viscous plays a very huge role over here. So it is almost like some sort of a small ball which is dropping through honey. So what is going to happen is that no wake generation can be seen over here. The flow comes on the left side, it is streamlined and then it goes over here on the right hand side. Very beautiful flow takes place and we can see it, the photographic evidence as well, very nicely over here. But this remains true only for low, very low Reynolds number. If we let us say what happens if we make Reynolds number 100 or 200. So somewhere in between 20 and 400. This type of regime now changes. So now you can see that there is a change in regime compared to the earlier one. In the earlier one, flow was symmetrical. So whatever is happening on the left side, happening on the right hand side, there is no recirculation zone. But now we are seeing this recirculation zone. What is this recirculation zone? Some sort of a zone which we can see over here. And this thing we can see in real life as well. So if let us say I am standing on top of a bridge, and this is the river which is flowing over here. So I will show in blue color maybe. So the river is flowing over here. So generally bridges will have certain pillars. So I am drawing the top view. So if there is a pillar over here and over here. So a person is standing at this point, let us say point A. So on this bridge there are two pillars and the flow is taking place like this. So what you might see over here is that some sort of the flow goes over here. Water is going, but over here you will see recirculation zone, which means here water is flowing very fast, here very fast and here very fast. but at this particular point they are recirculation zones, which means by chance if some plastic packet or some floating thing, some floating debris is caught over here, then it will keep on recirculating for 3-4 hours at this particular point, because it is not able to come out over here. But if that paper plastic or some floating device is over here, it will immediately go in that direction. So, that is what is the recirculating zone. So, we can see it in our real life as well. So, it is something over here, and I think it is very faint, but we can see the recirculating zone over here as well. So, this is the photograph of the wake of the sphere. So, this portion is known as the wake of the sphere. And we have also had experience of that. Let us say I am driving a motorcycle on the highway, I am on the left lane, and then suddenly a very high speed big truck passes me, and he has not touched me in any way. But once it actually goes away, then our motorcycle feels a little bit of some force is felt. That is because once the truck has gone ahead of me, then I have entered the wake which he is actually leaving behind. And in ships and boats also, if some boat is going in this particular direction, then it will leave some sort of a wake in behind over here. So, if this boat is going over here, so this is the wake over on this particular side. So, I think this thing, the concept is clear, we have all seen it. Now, let us see this thing in 3 dimension. What exactly is this recirculating flow? It is some sort of a ring that we are seeing over here. So, if you go back, how did this particular circles become ring? So, maybe I will erase this particular point. So, this figure is actually shown in 2 dimensions. So, if I rotate the whole thing on this axis, so these 2 loops will actually join together and they will become a ring. So, whatever thing circles I am seeing on the top view, if I make it in 3 dimension, this circulation region over here also, if I join it in 3 dimension, it will become ring, and these are the vortex rings which are being shed from behind the sphere, and cylinder also it takes place, and still the Reynolds number is not very high, we are at 350 Reynolds number. What happen if we increase the Reynolds number little bit further? So, these vortex rings now start to become vortex loops. So, this is our sphere over here, and behind this, this is the wake region over here. And what we see, very beautiful images shown over here taken from the gallery of fluid motion, this is actually the wake region, this is the vortex loops, and you can see there is a horseshoe shaped loops as well, this, that kind of horseshoe shape we can see over here. And this happens in the Reynolds number between 400 and 1000. And this particular vortex loop which are being shed, first the vortex ring was being shed at 350, then it becomes vortex loop, and there is an animation over here. So, this is a numerical simulation, and I think this one is giving the top view and this one is giving the side view of the same thing. And again, like yesterday we were seeing that one vortex comes out like this one from the top side, and then one comes from the bottom side, then another one from the top side, another one from bottom side. So, if I put some sort of a cloth in between over here, then it is going to wave something like this, because this thing when it is there, then this one is here. So, very interesting vortex shedding we are seeing over here. Then we look at higher Reynolds number, what happens? So, please pay attention to this high value over here. So, this is kind of very close to the critical Reynolds number, right? So, till this particular, this is the wake. This is the wake behind the sphere, and this is the wake behind the sphere. So, if I call this as case A and I call this as case B, now I will ask that question, if I am playing golf or if I am driving a cycle through a competition and my body is acting like a bluff body, do I want a bigger wake or a smaller wake? So, in think in terms of that pressure drag term that we had talked about earlier. So, pressure drag, let us say on this flat plate, if the force is acting like, if the flow is going like this. So, there the point pressure here is P A, here the pressure is P B. So, P A is much greater than P B, sorry, P A is greater than P B. So, in order to minimize this drag force, which is simply area multiplied by P A minus PB, I want either of 2 things. One is that the pressure difference becomes less, which is not much in my hand, or the area becomes small. So over here, the once the wake area actually becomes small, so surprisingly our drag will actually go down. So over here in the top case, we are saying that the boundary layer is still laminar. So over here it is the laminar boundary layer, and over here the boundary layer is somewhere over here. Here the boundary layer has turned turbulent, it has become turbulent boundary layer. So in real life applications, as shown in this photograph over here, the wake is very big wake, and here the wake is small wake. So what is the consequence of this reduction is given very beautifully in this drag coefficient curve over here. So drag coefficient is essentially, I think it is defined on the next page over here. So this one is FD divided by area divided by half rho V square into the projected area. So that is the drag coefficient. So we can have drag coefficients for spheres, cylinders, for all sort of bodies. And now we are talking about the golf ball over here. Now comes the interesting point, that the drag coefficient is slightly decreasing as a function of Reynolds number, this we are seeing over here. But what happens at this point? Just imagine at this point, if I can draw this green line, suddenly the drag has reduced from point A to point B immediately. Can we see that? And this is happening for the cylinder as well. If I can draw it cylinder in blue color, over here it is maybe this P, and over here it has suddenly dropped to Q. And CD is kind of given on the y axis, it is the indicator of the drag force, we can see from here. So what that actually tells me is that in order to reduce the drag force, I want lower and lower value of CDs, the drag coefficient. Now comes the trick which we can play when we are saying that, okay, when we are converting, what is happening when we are going to point A to point B? Point A having the laminar boundary layer, point B having turbulent boundary layer, point P is having the laminar boundary layer, and point Q is having the turbulent boundary layer, which means I want to make the flow or the boundary layer, not the whole flow is not in my control, but the boundary layer, if I can do, I want to make it from transition from laminar to turbulent very quickly. Now how do I do that? I think before I go to that curve over there, I can explain very quickly. Usually we have to wait for the boundary layer to go from laminar to turbulent like this. But let us say I am an engineer and I want for some particular application that, sir, is there a way that the whole boundary layer from starting itself it become turbulent? So I can do it by tripping the flow. I can put a trip wire over here. So this is kind of a trip wire, or like how I am doing in my cup of tea, I am perturbing the flow. Is there a way I can perturb the flow? So earlier on, if the flow was all circular, it was very laminar flow, but then I take a spoon and not only I rotate clockwise, counterclockwise, up and down, then the whole thing becomes turbulent. That is what these dots or dimples on the golf ball are actually trying to do. They are trying to make the transition from laminar to turbulent as soon as possible. And this thing is explained now on the next slide with the help of the roughness factor. So this large, this one pink color curve over here, which I am highlighting with green, this is for the smoothest ball, because this ratio is giving the relative roughness. So if we have the very smooth ball, it is going to follow this green curve, which I am drawing over here. As I increase the roughness, so I can go from roughness 0 value to this value to this, and extreme roughness will be the golf ball. Then just look at what happens to the drag coefficient over here. So the drag coefficient, I would say, can reduce drastically. Which color should I put over here? Let us say I am at a given Reynolds number. So I fix a Reynolds number, and that fixed Reynolds number I will draw an orange line. So once I fix the Reynolds number, because Reynolds number is given on x axis, which means I have this vertical line over here. So on this particular vertical line, let me ask a question with the blue dots over here. Do I want to be on this dot A or on dot B or on dot C? for my given sphere of the fixed diameter and fixed velocity. How is diameter fixed? I am constraining that all the balls that I will use will have the same diameter. So, diameter I am fixing. Velocity I am fixing, why? Because Reynolds number I have also fixed. That is why I have drawn this orange curve. If I go back, only if I fix velocity, then I can say Reynolds number is fixed. Fluid also I have fixed, so this thing is also kinematic viscosity I am not changing, nu. Nu value I am not changing because the fluid is same for all the three cases A, B and C, which means directly students can now figure out that sir, we would like to be in the case C where the drag coefficient is lowest, isn't it? And drag coefficient lowest means if I hit this ball with the same power, if I have three balls A, B and C, A is very smooth, B is medium smooth and C is like a golf ball, because my power is same, whatever time I hit it, I cannot increase that power. If I hit it with the same power, though initial velocities are same, diameter of three balls are same, the fluid in which it is flowing, that kinematic viscosity is same. Now, because of this particular curve over here, if I have early transition with the dumped golf ball, then because of high roughness, CD value will be lower, which means the ball which I hit equally hard with the golf ball, it may travel the farthest because it is feeling the lowest retardation, the lowest drag force it is feeling. So, with the same impulse it can go maybe 400 meters, a smooth ball maybe only go 250 or 200 meters. I am just giving some numbers. So, numbers are not important, but the concept is important. I hope students are able to understand that. So, that is why I wanted to spend little time. And what we are doing with that, the physics I have already discussed, that something with the wake we are trying to do, that if it is the laminar boundary layer, wake size is usually high. Let us make it turbulent, wake becomes small, and then as engineers we are trying to tilt it in our favor. Now let us try and see. So, this thing we have looked for sphere, similar thing is also true for cylinder, but cylinders we do not kick or throw away for long distances. So, that analogy we do not see in real life, but if we want to make the cylinder rough, then suddenly its drag coefficient will decrease, that we are seeing over here for cylinders as well. So, smooth cylinder if it is there, then if we have the transition from laminar to turbulent, suddenly the drag will reduce. Okay. Now, the same concept may happen for, let us look at the Nusselt number as well, because first we have looked at the momentum part, now we looked at the Nusselt number thing. Now, what it is showing is over here, if we have cylinders of different type of cross sections. Now, again please remember one thing, for all these Nusselt numbers, we do not have to remember any of these tables. Usually in real life, in industry, these things are available to us in reference books, but concept we have to remember that all these equations I can generalize with one simple correlations over here, which is C is Reynolds to the power m and Prandtl to the power n. And we see in this particular table, which is having different values of Nusselt number, and why is it differing? Because it is looking at different type of design. So, I can have a cylinder of maybe circular cross section. So, these are very common cylinders, you take a circle, protrude it and then you get a circular cylinder. I can also have a square cross section cylinder, which would be something like this. So, in both these cases the fluid is flowing inside as well as outside this particular cylinder. So, over here, in this chapter we are taking that type of flow which is taking place outside, but in next chapter internal flow we will also take the fluid which is flowing inside. So, our focus may change, but application would remain the same. Similarly, we can have the, instead of square, we can have the tilted square, hexagonal shape or even maybe octagonal, vertical plate type of the cylinder or even ellipsoid. So, ellipse cross section cylinder we can also have. And just look at the correlations which are usually obtained empirically or through curve fitting. So, the only thing that we have to take care of is which Reynolds number regime we are in. So, if in the case of the circular cross section cylinder, we can figure out the Reynolds number, we can just pick which equation we can choose from over here and we will be able to give the solution for that. So, I think this is very straightforward and it is kind of very simple, like we have obtained for the case of the flat plate. I will quickly go back, because for flat plate we had these correlations we have obtained. So, again we do not have to memorize them, But the trends we have to memorize, that even over here we are getting Nusselt number is a function of C, Reynolds to the power m and Prandtl to the power n. So, this concept I think all students should remember. With that, I think we have come to the end of this particular chapter. Let us summarize what we have looked at over here. We looked at very important concept and the difference between the laminar and turbulent flows, and we looked at the how does the flow property actually influence the fluid property. So, that apparent thermal conductivity and apparent viscosity actually increases because of the flow going from laminar to turbulent. So, these are the correlations we obtained. Then we looked at the external flows various types, and we looked at the correlations which are given over here for coefficient of friction. Then we looked at correlations for laminar and turbulent case, for Nusselt number as well. Then we moved gears and switched on to spheres and cylinders, and very, very interesting concept of the golf ball we tried to analyze by looking at the different flow regimes, starting with very low Reynolds number to medium Reynolds numbers. We looked at the concept of vortex rings, even vortex loops, vortex shedding animation we have looked at, so very interesting things. And then we looked at reduction in wake size when it goes from the laminar boundary layer to the turbulent boundary layer at this critical Reynolds number, around 2 into 10 to the power 5 or so. And that 2 into 10 to the power 5 corresponds to this value over here, and we can call it the Reynolds critical. And over here we found very interesting phenomena taking place. Boundary layer goes from laminar to turbulent, drag reduces immediately because the wake size becomes small immediately at that particular point. And this thing we can do by making the ball rough at much lower Reynolds number as well. Okay. So, here we were trying to compare three cases A, B and C, and we figured out C is the best case to be used as a golf ball, because then the drag coefficient is lowest, ball will travel the furthest distance ahead, and we can win by a less number of strokes. So, I think with that we have come to the end of this course, this particular lecture, and I thank all the students. We will meet again, and then we will look at the concepts behind forced convection in internal flows. Thank you.